So welcome back everyone. We have seen last lecture how to write group multiplication tables, right? And we have also seen the detailed properties of groups using some solved examples. Let us now see how a group can be divided into smaller subgroups. So what is the definition for a subgroup? So subgroups can be formed. A subgroup So subgroup can be formed within a larger group such that the order of the subgroup, let us call that order as G, is an integral divisor to the order of the group, which is H, right? So in other words, if you take H by G, this should be equal to K, where K is an integer. So that should be very clear. So now let us take an example. Let us quickly write a GMT group multiplication table for water. The water is C to V point group, right? So this is E, C to Z, sigma XZ, sigma YZ. So we will see that how within this group, we can find a subgroup using GMT, okay? So subgroup by definition, the subgroup should follow all the four properties of group, like the closure, associativity, identity and inverse. Okay, so that is understood because from the name it is subgroups C to Z, sigma XZ, sigma YZ, right? So let me write easy ones first. E into E will be E, C to Z into C to Z will be E, sigma XZ into sigma XZ will be E again, sigma yz to sigma yz will be E, right? That is easy. And then the first row, E into anything will be C to Z, will be same. It's like multiplication with 1. Similarly here, this will also be same. Now the rearrangement theorem says that no two element in a group in a row or column can be repeated. So in this row, we have seen that C2 and E are already there, and in this column sigma XZ is already there. So the only option to write here is sigma YZ. And you can also test that if I apply. So the meaning of writing sigma YZ is that if I apply C2Z first and sigma XZ, I should have sigma YZ, which can be easily tested, and I leave it for you to test it on this molecule. And now the fourth element here, the only option is sigma XZ, right? It's like solving Sudoku puzzles. So again, so we have E, C to Z, sigma XY, so the only option we have is sigma YZ. And now sigma XZ, right? Here we have E, sigma XZ, sigma YZ. So we are left with C2Z, and we are left with C2Z here, okay? So that is a quick way to write group multiplication table. Now let us see that the order of this group is H is equal to 4, okay? So the subgroups can only be of order. So G can take values of 1, 2, or 4, because these are the only options where K is an integer. If, let's say, if you consider G equal to 3, then 4 by 3, this 4 by 3 would not be an integral divisor, and thus a subgroup of order 3 cannot be formed in this particular case. subgroup of order 1 can be formed, and subgroup of order 2 can be formed, but not necessarily. Okay, so it may or may not be present, but these are the only subgroups which may be present. So let's see. The first thing is the subgroup of order 1. E will always follow all the properties of subgroup, right? So E will be a subgroup always. So let us now see, do we have any other subgroup of order 2? So E, C2Z, C2Z, E. So if you notice that this will be another subgroup. Similarly, if you think that E, sigma, XZ, sigma, XZ, E, that will be another subgroup. So let me paint it with a different color. So you can see that, right? So this is a different subgroup. And then we have another subgroup, which is, right, with E and sigma, YZ. So it will have different subgroups of order 2. Similarly, now subgroup of order 4 is basically the full group, so that also does not count. So basically there are two subgroups of order 1 will be, so let's say if we call it as C2V has the elements E, C2Z, sigma XZ, sigma YZ. I can always say that subgroup 1 will be E, subgroup 2 will be E, C2Z, and so on, right? So we can write subgroup 3, G3 will be, this is not the order, so group 1, group 2, or we can say subgroup 1, subgroup 2. Subgroup 3 will be E, sigma Z, sigma XZ, and subgroup 4 will be E, sigma YZ. So I hope this is very clear. So subgroups basically can be found within larger groups, and the order of the subgroups have to be integral divisor. So that should be very clear. Now let us look at the other classification of group elements into smaller units, which are called as classes. Okay. So before we actually try to understand what is a class, let us first try to understand. We will come back to this classes, but we first need to understand an operation called as similarity transformation. Some of you already know this from other courses, but let's try to work it out here. Similarity transformation. For example, if you're taking NMR course, the similarity transformation is also discussed there, right? Okay, so the idea is if A, B, and X are three elements of a group such that A inverse B A is equal to X, we call X is the similarity transformation of B. Okay. Or we can also say X and B are conjugate to each other. What does it mean? We will come to that. What is the physical meaning of that? So, but the definition is clear. So similarity transformation, if A, B and X are three elements such that A inverse B, A is equal to X, then we call X is the similarity transformation of B, or we say that X is the conjugate of B, and we will show that B will also be conjugate of X. Okay, so let's try to look at few properties of conjugates or under similarity transformations. So properties So first property is every element is a conjugate with itself. So this means that if we have any element A, then there must be some element, and we will show how to prove it, some element X, or at least one element X, such that A is equal to X inverse AX. This is the definition from similarity transformation. Now we are saying that there has to be one element X in a group. If we have an element A, there must also be an element X in the group such that this relation holds, so that A is a self-conjugate. Okay, so now how do we prove this? So let us see. If we multiply A inverse on both sides, what do we get? A inverse A. So we have A inverse, X inverse, A and X. This implies that we have E is equal to A inverse, AX, which is equal to, if you remember that the inverse of the product is equal to product of inverses in opposite order. So that means we can write A inverse as X A whole inverse into AX, right? And this will only be possible if, so let's go to, so E is equal to X A inverse AX. This will only be possible if X A is equal to AX, right? Then only we can write that this will be AX whole inverse, and then the AX inverse into AX will give you E, right? So that implies that X and A must commute with each other, right? That means you must have an element X which should commute with the element A to prove that A is a self-conjugate. Thus, X must be present in group such that, right? So we know that there is always an element E which commutes with all the elements. So there is definitely an element E present which commutes with all the elements, and thus we can say that A is conjugate to itself. Okay, so now let's look at the second property. If A is conjugate to B, then B is also conjugate to A. That means both are related to each other by similarity transformation, right? So now let's see what does it mean mathematically. That means basically what we are trying to say is, if we have X inverse B, X is equal to A, then we must have an element Y such that Y inverse A, Y is equal to B. So we are saying that if A is conjugate to B, then B must be conjugate to A, where A, B, X and Y all are elements of a group, right? So now let's start with this x inverse bx equals to a, and we can multiply both sides by x inverse. Okay, so what do we get? X inverse b x inverse is equal to x a x inverse. We can do that, right? It's a matrix multiplication. So now what do we have here? So this goes to e, this goes to e. So basically what we've got is b is equal to x a x inverse. But we wanted y inverse a y is equal to b. So now this is possible only if, let's say, if x inverse is equal to y, then we can write the above relation as y inverse a y is equal to b. Now we know that in a group each element must have an inverse, so that means y must be present as a x inverse, and thus since y is present, so we can say that the b is also a conjugate of a, right? So if a is conjugate of b using a, so then b is also conjugate of b using y as a for a similarity transformation. I hope this is clear. Let me know if it is not. So third thing is, like, if two elements are conjugate to a third element, when I say element I mean group element, not symmetry elements, to a third element C, let's say if two elements, let's call them A and B, if two elements A and B are conjugate to a third element, then they themselves are conjugate to each other. Alright, what does it mean? So that means what I'm trying to say is, if x inverse ax gives you c, y inverse by gives you c, then there must be an element z in the group such that z inverse z is equal to b, then there must be another element m, let's say, also you can show m b m should be equal to a, because we have already shown this, so I'm not going to show this part. So this we have already shown, if a is conjugate of b is conjugate of a, then a is conjugate of b and all. Okay, but the point here is that if c is conjugate of a, c is conjugate of b, then a and b are conjugate to themselves. Okay, so now how do we prove this? So again, let's start with x inverse a x equals to c equals to y inverse b y, and now multiply x inverse on both sides. Then what do we have here? X inverse a x inverse is equal to x y inverse b y x inverse, right? Now this side, this becomes e, this becomes e, so we are left with a, and we have here we have x y inverse b, and we have y x inverse. Okay, So now let us assume xy inverse is equal to z inverse. This comes from properties of group. So if we have z inverse over here, and now if we take inverse of the whole thing, xy inverse of the whole thing, then we get z. Now this thing we can write it as y inverse inverse and x inverse, which is now equal to z, right? So this becomes y x inverse, right? So this term becomes now equal to this. So this implies that a is equal to z inverse b z. So that means if x and y are elements of the group, z is also an element of the group because it is related by product relation or combination relation. Thus, a and b are proved to be conjugate of each other, right? So that should be very clear. So now coming back to definition of class, okay? Now that we have understood what is a conjugate, so let's look at the definition of class. So a complete set of elements, group elements, or symmetry operations that are conjugate to each other are called as class, okay, or are classified as class. So let's see what it means again. So let us quickly look at some group which will have some classes. So let's look at C4V. The operations are E, C4, C4 cube, then you have C2, then you have sigma V1, sigma V2, sigma D1, sigma D2. Okay. Now to identify the class elements in this C4V example, you can take anything like square pyramidal. Okay, so to identify what are the elements which are forming a class, you have to take similarity transformation of each element using by each element. Okay, so what do I mean? So let's take, if I'm taking similarity transformation of E by E inverse E, C4 inverse E C4, C4 cube inverse E C4 cube, C2 inverse E C2, and so on. So what do I get here? In all these cases, you will see that I will get E, nothing else, right? So then we can say that E is a class in itself. So E always forms a subgroup, and similarly E forms a class also. Okay. So E is a class in itself. Now let's also look at other operations. Let's look at C4. Okay. So if you have a group multiplication table, finding these products is much easier. So that's why the importance of group multiplication table. But let's look at this. So E C4 inverse E, what do I get? C4. Now let's say if I do C4 inverse C4, C4. So what do I get if I do this multiplication? So C4 into C4 will give me C4 square, and then C4 inverse will be equal to, so let's, shall we do that, or we should either get C4 or C4 cube. Okay, I'm leaving it as a home exercise for you to do it because there is not much time now. So let's try to make a point. So let's c4 cube inverse c4 c4 cube. This should also get c4 slash c4 cube. Either of this will come out as an answer. But what you have to do is you have to, if you write this group multiplication table, it is easier because then we know what is the product of each. Otherwise, what you can do is you can actually take a molecule, do this operation and see what you are getting. Okay. Similarly, do it for C2 inverse C4 C2 and see what you are getting. Okay. So now when I do these operations on C4, I get either C4 or C4 cube. Okay. Similarly, when I do these operations, these similarity transformations onto C4 cube, I get either C4 and C4 cube. So that means this tells me that C4 and C4 cube form a class. C2 will be a class. So again, try to identify whether C2 will be a class in itself, just like we did for E or C4, again do it for C2. So what I mean is then you have to do all the operations to identify what are the conjugates of C2. C4 cube inverse C2 C4 cube and so on. So calculate, and every time you will get C2 as an answer. There is no other element which you will get, right? Similarly, if you do similarity transformations of sigma V1, you will get either sigma V1 or sigma V2. Okay, so that means these sigma V1 and sigma V2 will be forming a class. Similarly here, if you do a similarity transformation of sigma D1, you will get either sigma D1 or D2. And if you do a ST on sigma D2, then you will get either sigma D1 or D2. So these two will form a class, these two will form a class, these two will form a class, this will be a class in itself, this will be a class in itself. Okay. So now try to work out yourself taking an example. Let's take an example. If you want an easier example, maybe take NH3 for C3V and see what are the elements which are forming a class. For class also, there is a condition that order of the class, just like subgroup, order of the class has to be an integral divisor to order of the group. So thus, the order of the group here is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. If H is equal to 8, the class orders which are possible are class orders which are possible are 1, integral divisor, 2, 4. Okay. But it is not necessary that all such integral divisor orders would form a class, because now you will see that there is a class of order 1, there is a class of order 1, and there is a class of order 2, 2, 2, but there is no class present for order 4 in this particular case, right? So this is the condition, but it is not necessary that all the orders which are integral divisors would form a class, okay? But if it is forming a class, it has to be an integral divisor of the original order of the group. Okay, so I hope this is clear. So we will take further like the physical significance of what is a class in the next class. Okay. All right. So that's all for today. Thank you.